the webinar at about 11:02. So thanks for your patience. All right. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Victor White. I'm Director of Marketing Communications at Gigya. For today's webinar, we have on hand Gigya CEO Patrick Salyer. And Patrick's going to be discussing how consumer identity is changing and specifically offer his 10 predictions for what will be happening with identity in 2015. Before I hand it over to Patrick, there are just a few logistics to cover. The presentation will last about 30 minutes, and that will give us plenty of time for Q&A following Patrick's presentation. And at any time, if you have any questions at all, you can go through the GoToWebinar questions window, and we'll address those questions at the end of the session. With that, I'll hand it off to Patrick to kick things off.
Great. Thank you, Victor. Thanks, everyone, for joining today. My name is Patrick Salyer, and I'm the CEO at Gigya. Do really appreciate your time. As Victor mentioned, you know, today we're really going to talk about consumer identities. And we're going to start by really defining what it is that we mean by consumer customer identity, talk a little bit about its importance to business. And then, obviously, the meat of today's presentation will be around kind of what we expect for this year, for 2015, to happen in the consumer identity space, provide kind of 10 specific predictions that we think really impact both consumers and businesses on the web. And then finally, we'll finish by talking a little bit about how Gigya is helping address some of these predictions. And then, as Victor mentioned, we'll try to leave some questions towards the end, or some time towards the end, to answer any questions you might have. Before we jump in, just to give you context, we'll dig into this a little bit more later in the presentation, but the perspective that I come from and Gigya comes from is actually pretty relevant to this topic. Gigya is the leading customer identity management platform, where we help over 700 enterprises. This includes 50 of the top 100 ComScore properties in the U.S. access, manage, and ultimately leverage consumer identity data. We're helping manage over 500 million identities on the web today. So this is a topic that we know quite a bit about, that we spent a lot of time on, and we're happy to talk more about today. Just to dig in and begin, what do we mean when we talk about consumer identity? And from the consumer's perspective, we really think about identity on the web really breaking down into a few main areas. The first is really around kind of the core information, kind of the core attributes of an individual. And this is usually accessed through registration. So think of this as profile information, which typically become things like first name, last name, age, gender, email, those sorts of types of information. The second thing that we think about when we think about consumer identity as it relates to an individual user is usually attributes that are often found on third-party identity providers, usually social identity providers. These are things like your interests and likes that may be on places like Facebook, or things like your work history that might be on places like LinkedIn. These are really important attributes of an individual's identity that can be accessed on the web, which we'll talk more about. Kind of the third piece is actually your behavior attributes, what a user is doing on the web. And this might be things like what the user comments on, what they share, what they purchase, different behavior attributes that can really tell you a lot about an individual. And finally, the fourth is really what we consider kind of system attributes. But this might be such things like location or a check-in. This might be things like opt-ins or opt-outs that an individual is giving you individual permissions about a consumer. If you kind of put that all together, that gives you a really complete view of an individual user, different consumers as they exist online across different multi-channel touch points, web, mobile, whatever it might be. Now, from a business's perspective, how is this identity usually interacted with and accessed? Well, really what we find is the foundation to accessing a consumer's identity on the web is really the registration and login process. And you can see Red Bull, one of our customers here, as an example. This is the gateway, if you will, for accessing this consumer identity. Of course, that happens, again, through kind of that traditional registration flow. You can see on the right-hand side where you would have a profile form that a consumer or user would fill out. But also, importantly, this idea of supporting these third-party identity providers, often called social login. That's where you're going to access a broader set of information. And there's over 40 different identity providers on the web today. In the U.S., the most prominent ones are those like Facebook or Google, Twitter, LinkedIn, those types of providers. And the key here, of course, for consumers, there's a real value to using a third-party identity provider. It's that whole idea that they do not have to create another username and password. The average consumer has something like 28 different accounts and 8 different passwords, and that actually is, that's a bit of an outdated stat, so that number is growing pretty exponentially. So it's much easier for consumers. For a business, the value is relatively obvious, but think about simplifying that sign-up and registration process for the consumer. So we actually see businesses get access to more consumer identities when they implement third-party identity providers. We also find that that business gets access to a much richer set of information. Again, that unlocks things like the consumer identity attributes around likes and interests and work history and those types of things that can come from places like Facebook and Google and LinkedIn. So really, again, that fundamental piece for business is accessing this identity through sign-up and registration, and that's the gateway for consumer identity management and really Gigya's offering that we'll touch on later. But for a business, when we think about identity and specifically customer identity management, what is the value that this really provides to a business? What are some of the challenges that this solves for a business? And without going into too much detail, you know, what we find is that when we talk to businesses today, identity can solve a number of really critical problems that they might be facing. One thing that we often see is that businesses have a disparate view of their customers. They might not be able to identify if it's the same customer across mobile, web, different websites, whatever it might be, or they may have multiple different databases or data stores where they don't have a consolidated view of that customer. And solving the identity problem can actually give you a consolidated, consistent view of the customer across any touch point, which is obviously extremely valuable today in the multi-channel world that we live in. A second challenge is acquiring known customers, knowing more about your customers. It's foundational to any business success. And ultimately, what we're doing when you think about consumer identity is facilitating known, registered, identified users, getting access to that rich identity information. Usually, when businesses struggle to get known, registered, identified customers, they might be actually purchasing quite a bit of expensive, inaccurate third-party data from data brokers. And this provides an alternative to that third-party data, data that you might access directly from the consumer or access, for example, through a social provider, tends to be much more accurate and actually a lot richer. And then if you go to that next point, it also doesn't have a lot of the privacy concerns around using data broker data, which we all know is pretty rampant. And then finally, driving results with customer data. We find that it's absolutely imperative to provide a customized, personalized experience on the web today. It's just what consumers expect. And providing this type of information, things like, again, those interests, likes, activities, work history, this provides deep capability to personalize all marketing, whether it's campaigns that you might be running, whether it's on-site experiences, whether it's more personalized advertising. So again, really critical business benefits that can be solved with identity. Now, let's dig into the meat of the presentation and really talk about, you know, given that we just defined identity is pretty critical on the web today, for sure critical for businesses and consumers, what do we think is going to happen in 2015 surrounding identity? What are some of the predictions that, Gigya has been able to identify by working with over 700 businesses and managing hundreds of millions of consumer identities? Well, I'm just going to jump into this one by one. And the first starting point here is really a prediction around Apple. And we really started to pay attention to what Apple was doing when they released Touch ID. And Touch ID obviously was the capability on the iPhone to use your thumbprint reader to actually authenticate within some activities within your iPhone. And that translated most recently into the Apple Pay announcement where you could actually transact by using your thumbprint reader and Apple Pay to actually make a payment. We expect this actually to broaden to support authentication across the web. So we expect within the next 12 months or so that Apple will release the ability for Apple ID to be a login provider the same way Facebook is a login provider, Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever that might be, and to tie the capability to leverage Touch ID to actually authenticate into a website. And this could be a really interesting use case for all of us here on the phone today because Apple has a lot of interesting things. They obviously have a tremendous amount of trust with their consumers. They have hundreds of millions of credit cards on file as well as things like shipping information. And then they have the ease and access of having the device that could authenticate you right in your pocket, being able to just use your thumb and quickly and easily authenticate. So this could be a really powerful, we believe, authentication mechanism, identity provider that could emerge in the next 12 months, and certainly something I think we all want to pay attention to. The second prediction is really around payment providers and how we think they're going to come on in a big way in 2015 to become mainstream identity providers for mobile. And this is something we've been paying attention to really the last 24 months where we've seen PayPal come on board as an identity provider and allow the ability to log in and register with a PayPal account onto different websites across the web and mobile apps. We saw Amazon do the same thing. So Amazon became a authentication login provider as well, and then Google Wallet followed suit. So this really interesting trend of authentication providers also being payment providers. So it wasn't just the social networks like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Google allowing registration, authentication, social login. It became these new providers. And the reason that we thought this was pretty interesting is because not only do you get that ease of not having to remember the username and password, but this could be one-click payments, which could include shipping information. And as more and more retail, more and more commerce and interactions are moving to mobile devices, we think it's going to become absolutely critical that you minimize the number of interactions that you require from a consumer to transact. And because something like PayPal, you can go to your web app, your mobile app, just have to put in the username and password, and that's going to include all payment information, all shipping information. On a mobile device, that's going to be an experience that's absolutely expected. So we fully expect PayPal and other payment providers to continue to take share this year. Moving forward, prediction number three is really around regulation about consumer data. And one of the things that we've noticed over the last 12 months is that there's emerging regulations that are coming from different governments around the world that are starting to become specific either by region or by individual countries that really will impact the way that business operators manage and leverage consumer identity data. And we don't have time to talk about this whole issue on this call, but one that we've been paying attention to is actually in Russia. And there's been a lot of talk about regulation emerging, and there's some question whether this happens in 2015 or 2016, but directly relate to the way that consumer identity data is managed and stored. And most specifically, there's some discussion where if you are a international business that happens to have users in Russia, you actually need to treat the Russian user data differently than you might treat users that might be in the United States, for example. And actually some discussion around needing to individually store those Russian users in databases that actually reside within Russia. And that's just one example. There's different discussions happening in countries all around the world. And so the point here being is we believe that there's going to be much more diligence required on how you think about how you're accessing, managing, and storing consumer identity data and start thinking about it region by region, country by country, rather than just what you're thinking about doing on a global basis. The next prediction is really around first-party identity data and how we think it's going to become more and more important on the web today. And first-party identity data is really the foundation for customer identities. And specifically, I mentioned earlier in the conversation around third-party data brokers and this ability to be able to buy and purchase data from a data broker. Well, that whole model largely relies on third-party cookies. And the whole third-party cookie model is a little bit crumbling due to the fact that cookies are not working really well in the new mobile world that we live in today, as well as a number of privacy concerns that are starting to emerge in places like Europe around third-party cookie data. So we believe that the trend is going to continue to push towards the value of first-party data, data that's accessed directly from a consumer that you're given permission to leverage as a brand to provide personalized, customized experience, especially as third-party cookies continue to lose favor on an ongoing basis. Fifth trend, what we anticipate is that Facebook will continue to gain share as the majority identity provider on the web today. And this was something we watched pretty closely over the last 12 months. 2013, we found that Facebook did not gain much share versus its competition. But that actually changed in 2014, where we saw quite a bit of incremental share gained by Facebook and actually taking share from other identity providers like Yahoo. And part of that is they've really figured out the secret sauce to value creation, both for consumers and businesses. On the consumer side, Facebook this year announced some more granular permissions where they allowed consumers to really choose how and what they share with a business. And that was something that we knew at Gigya consumers were asking for. They really wanted transparency with how their data was going to be used. Facebook delivered it, and they got incremental share. For businesses, Facebook continues to provide really interesting data that the business can use to provide more personalized, more relevant experiences. So they've just really seemed to get that kind of secret sauce right. So we think that will continue as we go into 2015. Another thing that we expect is Yahoo share will continue to drop. And this is might be the most obvious trend that we identified of the top 10 trends. As you can see, over the last 6 or 7 quarters, their share has really just dropped off a cliff. And part of that goes back to kind of what I said before is, while Facebook's getting that value, right between, businesses and consumers, Yahoo really hasn't put a lot of energy to really provide a tremendous amount of value to either of those constituents, so we just expect that to continue. Now, trend number 7 is really around leveraging customer identity to provide personalized, modern marketing. And what we've seen today is that customers are demanding really this one-to-one, personalized, customized experiences. And if you look at kind of the new winners on the web today among businesses, they are those companies that are providing a tremendous amount of personalization. If you look in the news category, what BuzzFeed has done to just gain a tremendous amount of page views, time spent. If you look in commerce, look at what Trunk Club has done around providing personalized shopping experiences. So we think that whole trend of personalization is going to win out. One-to-one is going to win out. Identity is critical to delivering on those types of experiences that customers are expecting. And to do it in the right way, to do it in a way that's privacy-oriented, do it in a way that's opt-in. And so the example we're sharing here with you today is one of the customers that we have, NFL, and something they're doing on the marketing side, where they're actually leveraging an individual's customer identity, most specifically some information that comes from Facebook, like who their favorite team is, as well as when their birth date is, and providing a personalized, customized email that goes out just a couple days before the consumer's birthday, asking if they want to buy a jersey and get a discount on that. And again, it's a jersey that's customized to my favorite team, and it's a jersey that comes, or it's an offer that comes right at the right time around my birthday. And so we expect this sort of experiences, that is a much more pleasant kind of personalized interaction to have with the brand, to continue, and these are going to be the experiences that win out. And these things are only possible if you're leveraging customer identity data. Finally, trend 8 really relates to something we're calling identity 3.0. And so what was identity 1.0 and 2.0, you might ask? Well, identity 1.0 was really kind of the first innings of identity, which you might remember Microsoft Passport and what they tried to do to become a ubiquitous identity provider on the web. Or maybe you don't remember because it really wasn't successful. But this was back, probably almost 20 years ago, where Microsoft made a big play to use a Microsoft ID to log into all sorts of sites around the web. It really didn't work because there wasn't a great value proposition for the consumer, for the business. Identity 2.0 is really something that worked very well, which was Facebook coming on the market and really becoming the next generation of identity provider, Google following suit, Twitter following suit, and providing a tremendous amount of value to both consumers and businesses, providing the ability for consumers to easily log into a website to get personalization, customization in that experience when they share their data, the ability for a business to drive registrations and to get more known information about consumers. Identity 3.0 is actually building on that. It's not losing any of that value that was provided from consumers and businesses around customization, personalization, the type of information that Facebook, Twitter, Google provided. But Identity 3.0 goes into kind of moving beyond passwords and enabling next generation methods of authentication, next generation methods to register and sign up to a business. And this will include things like we talked about biometrics with Apple ID. There's also a number of businesses that are working on mechanisms to actually use things like imagery, your iPhone's camera, for example, to be able to authenticate you by just taking a picture of your face, or even doing things like authentication through voice. And so in this Identity 3.0, authentication as we know it will change dramatically, but this is going to be great for businesses because this means that you can have a greater percentage of known identified customers across touch points and do that in a deterministic way. Do that in a way that you have a high level of confidence that's the same user across all of these different devices. And finally, trend 9. This really will be around consumers demanding more control over their identity data. And, I think that consumers are really starting to pick up on the idea of what's happening on the web to their data. And they're starting to realize that with the proliferation of data brokers, they don't have a lot of control over who's seeing what type of data. A lot of that data is inaccurate. It's providing, in some cases, very creepy experiences that they really don't want. And so there are going to be some pushback on that. And at the same time, you're having some frameworks and regulations start to emerge, and this is one that we're watching pretty closely, which is the Bill of Rights, the Consumer Internet Privacy Bill of Rights that Obama is putting forth and really trying to get some buy-in around, which at its foundation, it's really pushing for more transparency in how data is being used, more individual control that consumers can manage things like opt-ins and opt-outs. And, we really believe that this will continue to be the model moving forward, where there's going to be a push away from leveraging this third-party identity data that's out of the control of the consumer towards first-party identity data, data that's controlled directly by the consumer with opt-ins and opt-outs, things that are transparent, but will still provide the opportunity for businesses to provide personalized, customized experience, but do it in the right way. And finally, you know, trend 10 is really kind of the future now, which is identity becoming central to the Internet of Things. And this is an example that I just think is really interesting, where we believe you'll start to see some interesting use case, like having your car talk to your thermostat, for instance, and the fact that I'm authenticated and registered into my car's in-dash entertainment system, for example, knowing that I'm driving home. And before I arrive home, it changed my thermostat to, since I wasn't home, maybe it was down in the 50s, to 74 degrees. So it's right at the level I want it to be, right when I want it to be. And that can only happen if Nest device is able to talk to my Volkswagen car and have those two things know that it's the same person, know that there's information being passed between the two, and it really becomes quite a futuristic use case. And then you can see Luna here, the smart bed that will talk to your coffee machine. So sort of identifying that I woke up at 5:30 a.m. And after I take a shower at 6, I want a fresh pot of coffee. And that ability for these two devices to talk will be, identity will be so central to making that happen, to do it in a safe and secure way. Because there'll be a lot of red flags that we need to identify and make sure do not happen when these devices start talking to one another. An example, a counterexample to my earlier one might be, you know, maybe I don't want my Volkswagen car talking to my insurance company because I might not be the best driver and I might not want them to know about it. So that's going to be have to be permissions that be, that are put in place thoughtfully to make sure that privacy is managed in the right way, permissions are managed in the right way. So, you know, as we kind of end the predictions, I think the key takeaway really is things are changing quickly. I mean, it is a dynamic landscape, and we think it's going to change dramatically, actually much more in 2015 with some of the advents of these new technologies, these new regulations, these changing consumer preferences than they did in 2014. So consumer identity is really something that needs to be looked at very thoughtfully, and you know, I think there's an opportunity to look at technology that's being used to take advantage of, to access, manage, and leverage consumer identity to make sure it's done in the right way. And related to that, you know, I'm going to spend 5 minutes here, not more, just 5 minutes to talk a little bit about Gigya's customer identity management platform and how we're helping businesses address some of these trends that we're seeing within identity. And to give you context, just a sense of scale of what we're doing, again, over 700 customers today. Our customers actually sit in 46 countries, so extremely global at this point. We've got over 7 offices worldwide. We're reaching over 1.5 billion consumers, managing hundreds of millions of consumer identities. And ultimately, what we see our job is really helping customers build better relationships by taking all these unknown users, these anonymous users that are coming to sites and apps, and turn them into known, loyal, engaged customers, really gain access and manage customer identity data at its core. And in terms of, you know, how we do that, we have a platform that really sits into three different areas: connect, collect, and convert. So the SaaS-based technology that ultimately each one of these connect, collect, and convert helps businesses access consumer identities, manage consumer identities, and then leverage consumer identities to impact ROI, to impact marketing performance and customer service performance. And I'll actually spend a slide on each one of these just so you can get a sense of the platform. But the whole platform starts with Connect. And this is where Gigya as a business helps our customers, again, access rich customer identity data through managing registration and login. And I'll go back to Red Bull as one of our examples of our clients, where we manage what we call registration as a service, which is a completely hosted, managed registration technology, where we're going to handle things like the authentication process, handle things like managing the username, password creation and management, managing support for third-party identity providers and integrate those within this flow. So the idea as a business is you don't have to spend any time building out, maintaining, handling that registration flow. We're going to do it for you and handle all the complexities. Just to talk about some of the nuances here, because you might say, you know, well, at its core, that's a pretty simple process. Well, it actually gets pretty complicated pretty quickly. So on the traditional registration flows, we actually handle things like progressive profiling. So one of the things that we've learned is that on initial registration, you really don't want to ask the consumer that much information. You want to simplify that process, get them registered as quickly as possible. But what we found is on subsequent visits, say the user comes back to the site, you actually have the opportunity to ask them additional profile fields. You can ask them, for example, how many kids do they have? What are their, what are their favorite sport? Whatever it might be, to build out a more complete profile on that consumer, on that customer. And that's something we've built in programmatically into the platform. We also can do things like risk-based authentication, do things like adding a second factor of authentication, in other words, sending a text message to someone's device if you think that this might not be the real person registering and logging in. Handling the password forgotten flows. So the number one help desk question is the forgotten password flow. It costs businesses a tremendous amount of money. Handling that and doing that right is extremely complex. And then, of course, supporting these third-party identity providers. Gigya supports over 40 third-party identity providers. New ones come on board all the time. So in the last year or so, that was PayPal that came on board, Amazon that came on board. We just add those so businesses don't have to manage that complexity. So if we think about what's going to happen in the next 12 months, we're pretty confident that Apple will come on as an identity provider. And so the commitment that Gigya has is we're going to handle, when Apple comes on board, that will just be a supported authentication mechanism, and then you as a business don't have to manage and handle that. And then finally, on the lower left-hand side here, what you're seeing is Gigya's backend. And what this shows you is because we're a completely SaaS-based, managed process for registration, we can actually allow technical or non-technical users to go into Gigya's backend and change the way that these registration and sign-up forms look. So they can add things like additional profile fields, add things like additional identity providers, add things like progressive profiling, and do so without having to build out a custom form each and every time. So you change something that, like making a change to a registration system, used to take probably a six-month time period. It now takes 6 minutes as a result, because this is completely hosted and managed. Now, importantly, Gigya has a lot of flexibility here, and we'd love to talk to you more about this in detail if you'd like to hear more about it. But one level is we completely host and manage every aspect of this flow. The other is we have full RESTful APIs, so you can integrate into things like connected devices. After that data is accessed, we really go to the second part of the platform, which is Collect. Collect is where we manage and store all of this rich identity data that we're getting access to, either the identity data that we're getting from traditional registration, the identity data that comes from third-party identity providers, or even identity data that comes from behavior attributes, so what a consumer is doing on your site, so what they're commenting on, sharing, purchasing. We call those data signals. So even those type of attributes, as well as things like location, opt-ins, opt-outs. All of that is sent and managed in our cloud-based profile management system that's really been designed from the ground up to store modern identity data. Identity data is complex. I mean, you're talking about hundreds of data fields for each and every consumer that comes from multiple different identity providers. It has to be linked into a common identity provider. There's all these compliance rules you have to manage. So how you store Facebook data is different than Twitter data, different than Google data, different than LinkedIn data. How you store data for consumers in Europe is different than the U.S., which is different than Australia. All of that complexity, Gigya has built into the platform to help you as a business manage and leverage. And then finally, all of this data is being indexed in real time, which means this data can easily be accessed and actually put into different systems to take advantage of. And that really gets into the third part of the platform, which is really how do you leverage this identity data to drive value? And first is, we unlock this value, provide a BI tool specifically for consumer data, customer identity data, to allow business stakeholders, whether it's the advertising operations team or the email marketing team or the customer insights team, to actually run queries against, what are the consumers that are registering, logging in, who is spending the most money and also likes a certain brand on Facebook, for instance. Or who falls in this age demographic, age 30 to 40, and happened to comment the most on my site in the last year. Any sort of query that you can do against our data profile management system can happen within Gigya's UI that we provide for business stakeholders. And ultimately, you want to take these insights and push them into your marketing and customer service tools. So we have over 50 different integrations with third-party marketing and customer service applications where data can automatically be pushed into these applications to provide more personalized, customized experiences. And so this could be the most popular email marketing platforms like Adobe, ExactTarget, SilverPop, Responsys, the largest DMPs, so you can actually run more effective advertising, things like Blue Kai, or Adobe Audience Manager, Lodeme, different ad-serving platforms like OpenX or DoubleClick, as well as running push notifications, Urban Airship, Push.io, whatever that might be. So ultimately, what we're finding is that when businesses integrate Gigya, not only do they more effectively get more known registered consumers, they get a more effective view of the customer across these different touch points, but ultimately they're going to increase email conversions, increase time spent on site, increase advertising CPMs by being able to easily put this data into action. Great. So really appreciate everyone's time today. Looks like we'll have a few minutes to ask some questions, but hopefully you got a better sense of why identity is super critical on the web today for businesses, what some of the changes that we expect in this next year, and how you can address some of those questions. So I'll turn it over to Victor to see if we have any questions.
Great. Thanks a lot, Patrick. And as Patrick mentioned, at this time we'll go through the questions that folks sent over. We got a whole bunch, and I'll try to get through as many of them as we can. If you have any additional ones, you can use the GoToWebinar questions window, and I'll get to them as best I can. But with that, I'll take a look at some of the initial questions here. And here's a good one, Patrick. Could you give more information on Identity 3.0 and how it differs from a more traditional identity?
Sure. Well, the way we think about Identity 3.0, it's really about sort of conceptually this next generation of what we anticipate identity providers to look like. And to talk about how it differs from what we think about Identity 2.0, when we think about Identity 2.0, really that's the advent of all of these social login providers, these providers like Facebook, which their core value proposition was ease of login for consumers as well as personalized experiences. And for businesses, we're going to give you access to rich identity information for customization. And really the change that we expect in Identity 3.0 is the authentication mechanism is not just going to be kind of a social network username and password, but we think there's going to be richer authentication mechanisms that mostly are driven off devices, actually. And so the things that we see being worked on, again, the most obvious one is instead of having to create a username and password to authenticate into a website, you could actually just put your thumb on, your thumbprint reader on your phone. And the most obvious one today is Touch ID, which doesn't support this yet, by the way, but we anticipate it will, to easily sign up and register, thus totally eliminating that username and password, which obviously has been the goal on the web for a long time. But you have to think about what else can you use on your device, for example, or even on your computer to drive authentication registration that's not a username and password. And another one, obviously is something like a camera, like being able to take imagery of your face and recognize that it is you with a certain likelihood and automatically register and authenticate. There's other people working on others, which are things like voice, and using voice to easily register and authenticate. And the key here is when you start talking about these different authentication mechanisms that's not just username and password, you start being able to have a higher level of trust as part of that authentication process. So you may have heard on the news today that TurboTax had some issues around people filing fraudulent tax returns, and they were doing that because they were able to steal someone's username and password on the web and register within TurboTax using the same username and password that consumer probably used on different websites as well. And one way that could be stopped in the future is require different levels of risk-based authentication that may involve things like both biometrics as well as visual identity, or voice as well as password, where you can get an extra level of authentic trust as part of that authentication process.
Awesome. Well, thanks, Patrick. And we definitely have some other really good ones here. And one of them that I think is worth addressing is, why do you think Facebook has such a strong lead on mobile relative to Google?
Well, you know, I think part of that is Facebook has just done a really good job on providing a tremendous amount of value, specifically on mobile authentication for businesses. So I think it's a more prominent choice for businesses to integrate Facebook login, and I think it's more frequently than Google login. That's primarily around the type of data that Facebook is providing, as well as a lot of people obviously have a Facebook application already installed in their phone, and Facebook has really eased the login process. If a user is already logged into the Facebook application, to log into another application that happens to use Facebook login, it's a very smooth and easy authentication. So they really provide a lot of value for businesses to support Facebook login, and I think that's one reason they've gained a lot of share.
Got it. Thank you. And another question here. What are your thoughts on the evolution of single sign-on across apps, devices, and platforms? And maybe before answering, it would be helpful just to define single sign-on so we're all on the same page.
Yeah. So single sign-on, the terminology is often used in a lot of different ways, but the way that we think about it is it's the ability for a user, a consumer, to authenticate into one website that happens to be managed or operated by a business that owns and operates a number of other websites. And the ability for that consumer to not only be authenticated into that one website, but to remain logged in and authenticated automatically into those other websites that are managed and owned and operated by that same business. And, you know, in terms of what we expect moving forward is, I just think it's an absolute expectation for consumers that type of experience happens. And I think businesses have known that for a long time, but a lot of the issues around it haven't so much been do we think consumers want it or not, but the technical problems around executing against that, which really does require you to have kind of a consolidated view and a consolidated approach to how you manage consumer identities. So, you know, I think the real winners moving forward are going to have to provide a very seamless experience for their consumers, and certainly single sign-on is going to be one of those must-haves, but it will take some investment on the side of taking a look at how the customer identity management is approached within the business.
Got it. Here's an interesting one on Apple joining the fray as an identity provider. What's the advantage for Apple to push for use of Apple Identity across the web?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that long-term it's just permanence and relevance, as well as payment revenue. Those are really the two. I'll take those one by one. So, you know, I think long-term this ability to whoever you use as your authentication mechanism around the web will give you kind of this long-term relationship with a consumer, with a user. And so that's one of the reasons we think Facebook has jumped into this in such a large way, which is there may be a number of users that aren't using Facebook on a daily basis anymore but still use their Facebook username and password to log in across the web. And because Facebook is predominantly moving into an advertising model where that's how they make money, if they still have you as a user that is maintaining their profile on Facebook and then is still keeping their account active because they're registering and logging around the web, they still have you as an active user in some sense, which is pretty valuable from them from a monetization perspective. Whereas, you know, MySpace didn't do that. And so MySpace, we don't think about them anymore. We don't use our MySpace IDs. So even though users went from MySpace to Facebook, we could see users go from Facebook to whatever's next but still maintain that ID, and that would become really valuable for Facebook. So this idea of leveraging an identity provider long-term across the web creates a lot of permanence for a brand that we think can be, you know, really strategic for them. But the second factor is probably the bigger factor, which is because identity is being tied to payments, becoming the identity provider of choice, not just to log into iTunes or your Apple, you know, other Apple products, but to log in across the web, you can start getting a share of that payment revenue, 1, 2, or 3% of the transaction if you're managing that payment process. That's really the long-term opportunity, we believe, around identity and payments, which will be really relevant for Facebook. It's really relevant for Google. It's really relevant maybe for, or excuse me, Apple, Google, maybe relevant for Facebook one day as well.
Got it. And it looks like we have time for one, maybe two more questions. And how about we go with how will new privacy regulations impact which identity providers gain traction?
Sure. Well, you know, I think largely what you'll see is identity providers will make changes to the way they operate to ensure that they're actually following, you know, the various consumer data regulations out there. That would be our prediction, and that's what we've seen historically. That being said, I think consumers will lean towards those that they feel that they can trust, that they feel that have transparency in terms of how the data is being used, and importantly, provide value to them in some way. And so, you know, some people might argue that one social provider might be, you know, have less trust than another social provider, but if it's providing a tremendous amount of value, you'll still get consumer adoption. So those things all kind of work together. But in general, I think you'll find that the identity providers will follow suit according to whatever the regulations do, and it's just a matter of kind of consumer adoption will be based on value that each one's providing.
And for our last question, this is very much related to the previous one. Which identity providers provide the best data for marketers?
Sure. So related to that, you know, Facebook's definitely going to really take the lead there. But I'll say that with a caveat. I mean, LinkedIn for professionals is obviously going to provide a different type of value, but a lot of value there. And then Google continues as Google is providing information across its suite of properties. So information like that can come from YouTube, for example, that becomes increasingly valuable over time. But certainly Facebook has provided the most value today. Now I'll say that with a caveat, which is if you're doing any sort of commerce transaction, whether it's a paywall or you know, whether you're selling goods online, whatever it might be. You know, I think that it deserves to really look long and hard at those payment providers that are identity providers, the PayPals, the Amazons, the Google Wallets, because ultimately to drive your bottom line, if you can streamline that that checkout process, that's going to be as valuable as the profile data that may come from a social provider. And keep in mind that you can augment profile data through the registration process as well, doing things like progressive profiling, which we do with a lot of businesses. So, you know, there's a lot of different ways to go after that, but I would not discount the payment providers moving forward.
Great, thanks. And, you know, that concludes the webinar. Just wanted to thank you, Patrick, for joining us, and for everybody else for joining the webinar today as well, and hope you'll all join us for future webinars that we put on. And if you have any questions at all following this, feel free to reach out to me directly. It's just Victor, V-I-C-T-O-R, at gigya.com. We will be making this webinar available as we've recorded it, and we'll send it out to make sure that you can share it as you see fit. Thanks so much, and that concludes the webinar.
Thank you all. I really appreciate the time.